Hello, Star Trek fans, and welcome to the Rebinge Deep Space Nine podcast. My name is Kim.
And my name is James.
And we're watching Star Trek Deep Space Nine from the beginning, one episode at a time. Welcome back to the podcast. Today we are on Season 7, Episode 16. Something, something Latin. You say it.
Inter Arma Enim Silent Leges.
Sure. This episode aired March 3rd, 1999.
Which I think is close enough. I mean, Latin's a dead language, let's face it. I mean, it's only used by attorneys when they want to sound clever.
And there's something about, like, the order of the words doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And I don't know. We do learn later in this episode that the title is meant to equate to the line, "In times of war, the law falls silent."
Yes.
They could have just called it that.
That would have worked as well, but then you wouldn't have sounded clever.
Exactly. Well, before we talk about this episode, do you have anything to say about last week's episode? Bada bing, bada bang.
Yes, I have an observation to make, which I should have made before the episode, which is the actor who played Zemo played a gangster in two Bond movies.
Yeah.
He was in Diamonds Are Forever, and he was a hitman in Man with the Golden Gun, who dies, I think, in like the first 5 minutes of the movies.
I see. Well, he certainly has the gangster look, at least movie gangster look.
Yeah. For the movie trivia amongst us.
But otherwise, the episode was perfect, don't you think?
I think so. Definitely.
Yeah.
Having a Tiba on the episode was more fun than the actual episode.
That's the first time a Tiba joined us for an episode that he didn't really like.
Yes.
Yeah. No, we had a great conversation. That was a good one. Well, you have the notes this week.
I do.
Would you like to begin?
Okay. We open on Kira holding what seems to be an operations meeting, and the Romulan senator, Cretak, is complaining that their ships are not being repaired quickly enough. I assume she's still a little bit salty from not being allowed to have their military base in the Bajoran system.
Well, because they recast this character, I didn't put that all together.
Ah.
Until way, way, way later, and I went, oh, wait a minute, this is the same character, but it's a different actress, because it was that woman from Seinfeld before, and now it's Adrienne Barbeau.
Wow.
That is an actress who has been on a million things, certainly in the 70s and 80s. I mean, she was on Maude, okay? She's been in things from Maude to Cowboy Bebop. This is an accomplished actress.
That's fascinating.
Yes.
Well, in the meeting, Kira shuts down an argument between Worf and Cretak over how Klingon ships are usually more damaged because they take the fight to the enemy, as Worf puts it, and Cretak calls the Klingon behavior reckless. To me, this makes total sense because I don't see the Romulans shouting, "Perhaps today is a good day to die," and plunging headfirst into a flotilla of Jem'Hadar. But you could see that with the Klingons.
Yeah, that's true.
Honestly picturing in this war a lot of Klingon ships coming out from a fight badly damaged and the crew saying, "Holy crap, we survived."
Yeah, it's such an interesting meeting here. I mean, it makes a ton of sense that the Klingon ships would be more damaged.
Yeah.
But you also at some point have to look at if you keep having to fix the same ships over and over again and you're not fixing other ships, you do have to ask yourself, am I prioritizing things in the right way?
Oh. Good question.
What I really liked was what Kira did was she didn't engage in the debate.
Yes.
She did a thing that I have to do in meetings all the time, which is, okay, we'll just table this and, you know, we can talk about this in a different meeting or, you know, this isn't the meeting for that conversation.
Yeah.
And you just sort of stop everybody. You're not saying you're wrong. You're just saying, oh, yeah, we'll talk about that later, which means we're never going to talk about that again.
Yeah. Well, in the meeting, Kira volunteers Worf to let General Martok know his ship is being bumped from repair so that some Romulan ships can go first. There's a little bit more needling about shore leave and the Klingons getting drunk in Quarks. Cretak really... Well, the Romulans just seem to needle the Klingons all the time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And they do it in that really snooty way, right?
Yes.
Because she says, oh, we're professionals.
Oh, yeah. Our troops won't be getting drunk.
Yeah.
Well, Kira ends the meeting and we learn that Senator Cretak will be attending a conference on Romulus. Before we leave this scene, I think we need to leap to management in the future.
Okay.
Kira says that they'll reconvene in a week. Do you think that is the best approach for this type of meeting, which seems to be a very operational meeting and having moving goals in that different ships will be coming in at different levels of damage, etc.? To me, this seems far better to be a 15-minute scrum style. It would appear you would need that much more rapid feedback.
Agreed. Yeah. Well, if you really want to talk about this.
Yes. Yes, I do.
I agree there should be a daily stand-up dealing with the constant operations, but this is a management-level discussion.
Yeah.
All of these people are not the people on the ground. And so those people are the ones that you want to have daily stand-up. So you might have a higher-level meeting with fewer people less frequently, just to make sure everything is going smoothly.
Yeah.
So, yes, there better be a daily scrum.
But would you agree that this seems to be needing a more agile approach?
Everything does. Miles should be having a daily stand-up.
Oh, very true.
But you wouldn't invite Kira to the daily stand-up.
We will now pause this podcast while we have a 20-minute discussion about velocity.
Oh, Lord. I guarantee we won't. And we also won't be talking about burn-down charts.
Ouch. You know, that leads into, do you think Miles maintains a Kanban board?
Well, yeah, he should. How else is he keeping track of anything?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Leaving our management discussions for a while and returning to Deep Space Nine, we go to Garak talking to Julian about how everything on Romulus is grey.
Weren't you shocked that they let Garak talk to Bashir finally?
Oh, yeah. Garak manages to display a little bit of that Cardassian bigotry as he calls the Romulans an unimaginative race. Garak, of course, was on Romulus, posing as a gardener, but won't tell Julian anything of exactly what he was doing there. Garak is in full spy mode, telling Julian that he hopes Starfleet Intelligence will be sending a spy along. Julian is rather surprised by this, saying the conference could usher in friendship between our peoples. Garak, very sarcastically, calls him the eternal optimist, and then says, how sad.
Yeah, I like it when he said that.
Yeah. Garak continues, saying, one day he hopes that Julian will see the universe for what it truly is, rather than what he wishes it to be. Julian replies that he will endeavor to be more cynical with each day, to which Garak says, if only you meant it. With a very Garak little grin.
Yeah.
These two are awesome. I love this interaction.
Yeah, this was such a cute scene. It really made me miss Garak.
Yeah.
We just haven't seen a lot of him lately.
Okay, some Garak headcanon here.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the reasons why Garak likes Julian, because he is this bizarre optimist. Garak will have spent his life around people who don't say what they mean, cover their true feelings, and are ruthless. Julian is very much, this is what he really believes. This is him up front. There's no deception. He honestly believes in, if you like, the goodness of people or the positivity. So it really is a different experience to everything he's used to.
Hmm.
And even the way Garak thinks.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty good point. To some degree, it's easier to be friends with people who are like you and agree with you all the time. But if we looked at what kind of a person that would mean Garak would be talking to, that's unlikely to be a friend.
Yes.
So it does make sense when you think about it that way, that he would be friends with Bashir, someone who is pretty open. I mean, that's not how they were first introduced, if you recall, season one. But that is how their relationship has evolved. So yeah, now they just seem to be pretty open with each other. Because even Garak is way more open than he used to be.
Right. He basically admits he was a spy on Romulus, but doesn't tell him what he was there for.
Says it right out in the open.
Yeah.
Which just even last season, I feel like he would have said, oh no, I was just a gardener there.
Right.
Before you leave this scene, I was really dismayed by Garak's outfit. It's so ill-fitting in this scene. It's like all bunched up around his arms.
Oh.
I mean, how disappointing for a tailor to have such an ill-fitting outfit.
He's been letting things go, obviously.
Yeah.
He hasn't seen Julian enough, I think, is the problem.
I mean, maybe. Maybe he doesn't have a mirror, and if he doesn't see Julian, nobody tells him, man, that thing doesn't fit.
Julian tells him the truth. Garak, you look terrible in that.
I feel like Julian would tell him.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Next, we're off to a darkened room with a silhouetted figure sitting in front of the window. Julian is in bed and then sits up, telling the computer to turn on the lights. And the shadow figure sitting in his bedroom is Sloan.
So creepy.
Sloan says, I hope you're well rested. Section 31 has an assignment for you. And into the opening titles.
It's so creepy to wake up with somebody staring at you in the dark.
Right.
If it were the 80s, he would have been smoking.
Oh, yeah.
Like cigarette smoking man on the X-Files. Although that wasn't the 80s.
Back from the credits, and Sloan is wearing his full leather outfit.
And Bashir's in his jammies.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure that leather outfit is sourced from the Mirror Universe. It looks pretty good.
Yeah.
He tells Julian he has an assignment for him. And although Julian didn't join Section 31, he's still been admitted. I like that. That was funny. It's like, oh yeah, you didn't actually join, but you're in.
Yeah, you didn't want any part of this, but you passed the test, so you're in. Okay.
He wants Julian to gather data on the Romulan leadership, Because they can't use technical means, they have to use human assets. Julian is very disturbed that they want to spy on an ally, but Sloan says, evaluate an ally.
Yeah.
That's some great doublespeak there. We go into some exposition as Sloan gives a summary of what's going to happen after the war. The Dominion will be forced back into the Gamma Quadrant, the Cardassian Empire will be occupied, the Klingons will spend 10 years recovering, which leaves only the Federation and the Romulans to vie for control of the Quadrant. Julian says, this war isn't over, and you're planning for the next. Sloan clearly seems amused by this, and he's also very much a forward thinker. He's planning a step ahead.
I mean, that doesn't seem bad, right?
No. Julian finally says he doesn't want to work for him. But Sloan confidently says, you will. It's in your nature. You love secrets, and I am a man of secrets. And then he leaves. Julian then takes out a phaser from his nightstand and runs into the corridor. But too late, Sloan is gone. And we get the brief appearance here of Ezri for like 2 seconds in the episode.
Yeah, who's just wandering the hall at night, I guess.
Yeah, that's the Duran side of her personality.
Oh no.
She likes to stalk the corridors at night. Yeah, it just makes her feel good. Into Sisko's office, and Odo reports he's found nothing on the sensor logs. Sisko then tells Julian that after talking to Admiral Stuffshirt, also known as Ross, the conference is still on, and because there's a chance to get some inside information on Section 31, Julian should go along with this plan.
And he tells him at the end of the scene that if Sloan ever finds out that he's really working for Sisko and Ross, that something bad will happen,
yeah,
is the implication. And to me, it's so funny to think that Sloan wouldn't know. Sloan comes and goes on the station as he pleases.
Right.
I'm sure he has listening devices everywhere. He's probably listening to this conversation.
Yeah.
It just seemed naive to be like, oh, don't let him find out. He knows.
Right. He's got to be ahead of everything.
Yeah. He's too much ahead of everything, which is a problem with the character.
Very true.
But he definitely knows.
We now go to a flyby of Voyager, which if you look at the numbers very carefully, we're pretty sure that they still have the NCC, was it 74565?
I don't remember the number, but yes, we looked it up. And that, yeah, this is a shot of Voyager, no doubt. And there's a number of scenes within the ship where you're like, okay, now we're on Voyager.
On board Voyager, or Bellerathon as they're pretending it's called, Senator Cretak is socializing with Admiral Stuffshirt and Julian. Julian uses the phrase, never say die, which Cretak finds very odd. And all of a sudden, in jumps Sloan to explain the etymology of the phrase, introducing himself as Wendell Greer from the Department of Stellar Cartography. He even, like, changes his voice and the way he's behaving to sound more like a...
A little nerdy.
Right. Another little nice touch there.
Mm-hmm.
After the party, Admiral Ross tells Julian that Sloan has a rock-solid cover, and Ross won't move against him because they may lose any hope of penetrating Section 31. He says if Sloan's here, it means there's something more important happening than simple intelligence gathering. So I think we get the first hint here that maybe Ross isn't doing the things he should be.
Something going on.
Yeah. In Julian's quarters, Sloan is showing him different Romulans and grilling him who they are. The first guy we see is Praetor Neral. Sloan changes the image to another Romulan, and this guy is called Koval, and he is the head of the Tal Shiar. Sloan goes on to explain how he is believed to be responsible for the death of the deputy chief of Starfleet Intelligence, who died mysteriously of food poisoning. But Sloan isn't buying that. He thinks he was murdered. Sloan continues, telling Julian that Starfleet doesn't know what Koval's political affiliations are, but he's not been given a seat on the Romulan Continuation Committee, which is surprising for the head of the Tal Shiar, but it's probably because he was one of the people opposed to the Federation Alliance. He says Cretak is likely to get this seat as she's very pro-Alliance. Sloan next brings up that Koval may be suffering from a degenerative disease called Tuvan Syndrome. If he is, it will hamper his chances to get onto the committee. What Sloan needs is for Julian, with his genetically enhanced abilities, to make a diagnosis only from physical observation of Koval.
Which he points out, the augments in statistical probabilities were able to do something similar.
Right.
Than only watching Damar speaking.
Yes.
And so he's like, you should be able to do just as well as them, which is a good point.
Do you think he was maybe playing to Julian's ego here a little?
Mm-hmm.
Saying, oh, well, you could just look at him and know.
Maybe. Either that or He's just using it as a way to knock down Julian's disagreement.
Oh.
Of, no, I don't want to do that. No, I can't do that. He's like, I know you can.
Yeah. Interesting.
I did like the Romulan who's standing there pretending to be a hologram. I thought that was really funny because he kept blinking.
Right.
I'm like, that dude's actually standing there.
Yeah. Yeah. Julian tells Sloan that interfering in the internal workings of a sovereign power is explicitly forbidden by the Federation Charter. Sloan delivers this great line here saying, let's make a deal, Doctor. I'll spare you the ends justify the means speech, and you spare me the we must do what's right speech.
Yeah.
That was great. I thought it was perfect. And it wonderfully sums up Sloan.
Yeah. Yeah. Sloan is like, I've already decided what side I'm on. Could you please stop preaching at me?
Yeah. I'd love to get Sloan together with Picard. That would be great.
Yeah. They could have some good discussions, some good debates.
Right. Well, it's off to Romulus, and now there's an informal mixer going on with the Starfleet personnel in white dress uniforms and the Romulans wearing grey outfits, and also completely lacking any shoulder pads.
That's true. And those white dress uniforms, they were from the movies at this point.
Oh.
I don't think we'd seen them before on the show.
Oh, interesting.
And has there ever been an episode with more cocktail parties? We're on mixer number two, and I think there's another one later.
Yeah.
Romulus does look like a total dump. In the outside
Does
shot.
Bit,
yeah, I think Garrick has proven right.
Yeah, and all the gray outfits. Not very much into color there. The only thing that would have made this better is I think they should have had a karaoke machine in there.
That would have been funny.
Well, at this party, Koval comes directly to Julian and displays all that pleasantry that we so used to with the Romulans. He seems way too interested in whether the quickening virus can be replicated. And at one point asking, do you know how to introduce the virus to a population? I really don't think you should be sharing everything with the Romulans if that's like their first question.
Yeah, especially after this conversation.
Yeah.
Julian thinks he wants to know about the vaccination, but he doesn't care about that.
Yeah.
He wants to know how to do the same thing.
Right.
Which, I mean, you have to be thinking about all options against the Dominion, but you definitely don't want the Romulans to have the ability to do this.
Very dangerous tech to put into the wrong hands.
Yeah, when this guy approaches Julian, Julian says, pleasure to meet you. And he says, why? Julian says, well, you got me there. Oh, I laughed. I thought that was very funny.
The Romulans are such a barrel of laughs.
Yeah.
Well, after this conversation, Senator Cretak congratulates Julian, telling him that that's the head of the Tal Shiar, and he doesn't usually talk to anyone in public.
Yeah.
My first thought here was, is she giving away state secrets? Even if you know who the head of the Tal Shiar is, wouldn't that be like non-public knowledge?
Hmm. I would think, yes, it would not be public knowledge who is in charge of the Tal Shiar. It's not like the CIA or the FBI. It's a secret organization, right? I think that's how it's introduced to us. Yeah. Well, maybe they're a little more open because we're allies now.
That's true. And Cretak does support the Alliance, so.
Right. And she doesn't like this guy, so.
Yeah. Now Julian is giving his lecture on the quickening, and sitting in the front row is Koval. After the lecture, Sloan, who is also in attendance, wants to know Julian's diagnosis. And from his observations, it appears Koval may have Tuvan syndrome. Julian tells Sloan that the disease is in an early stage, and it will progress slowly. Then Sloan asks, so what could trigger its acceleration?
Yeah. And then Julian's like, I don't know what you're asking. He knows what he's asking.
Yeah.
We all know what he's asking.
Right. The other thing in this scene is Sloan seems really unfazed about Koval wanting to get his hands on the quickening virus.
Yeah. He's like, yeah, we want that too.
Yeah. I liked how he pointed out to Julian that these are not nice people we're dealing with.
Right.
In Admiral Stuffshirt's office, Julian is explaining how Sloan intends to murder Koval and how he is very concerned about who gets the empty slot on the continuation committee. Ross goes on to tell Julian he'll have Sloan confined to quarters and suggests that Sloan maybe has another member of Section 31 here. Julian, however, thinks the accomplice must be on Romulus because of all the inside information Sloan seems to have, and he suspects it's a Romulan. Ross insists he can't tell the Romulans about Section 31. A rogue element of Starfleet carrying out assassinations? He says, Julian needs to sit tight.
I thought that was a weird line
from
Ross. And maybe there's multiple things here that are weird. First of all, when Julian says, oh, he knows too much, it's like, yeah, he's in intelligence. That's the point.
Yeah.
They're always going to have information and they're always going to have informants. That's how it works.
Right. And Sloan said earlier about how he's a man of secrets.
Right. But when Ross says this line about all hell would break loose if the Romulans find out there's a rogue Federation agency running around plotting assassinations, yeah. I mean, I would assume that that's what the Tal Shiar is doing all the time.
Right.
So I don't think all hell would break loose. I think they would be like, no, yeah, sure. Yeah. We do that too.
You know, that ties back to Garrick talking about Section 31 and saying, I'd be surprised if Starfleet didn't have a section like this.
Yes, and so would the Romulans.
We go to the mess, and Julian then overhears two crew talking about an admiral who collapsed at his desk, and they think it may be an aneurysm, and discovers that it was Ross, and he's in sickbay. As Julian leaves, he sees Sloan, who's also in the mess, laughing and sharing a drink with another Starfleet officer. And he tips his glass at Julian as he leaves.
Scary.
Yeah. So Julian goes to see Cretak. He tells her there's no one else he can turn to, and Sloan has an accomplice in the government. Cretak tells him that Koval believes there is a traitor in the Romulan Senate. Julian now asks her to get a hold of Koval's personal database, as he's likely to have a list of suspects. He thinks that the two of them together could figure out who the traitor is. She seems very shocked at this idea, saying, you're asking me to hand over state secret documents.
Well, but she doesn't have to do that. She could just go and look at it herself and make her own conclusions and come back with a suspect. You know, she doesn't have to give him the whole database.
Write the list of names down.
Yeah.
Julian asks her to put 3 centuries of mistrust behind them. Otherwise, a man will be murdered. So he's doing that. We got to do the right thing here.
It seems so unlikely that a Romulan senator is going to be willing to do that.
Right. Especially with what I would imagine she would have had to have done to get to this point.
Right.
And especially look what she did with the Bajorans, to steal Sloan's line. These are not nice people.
Time for another party.
Julian goes back to talk to Sloan, telling him that Koval might not have Tuvan syndrome after all. Sloan says they'll put a microcellular adhesive on Julian's hand so he can get a skin sample when he shakes Koval's hand, and then they can run tests to be sure that he has the disease. Julian agrees to this, and we go off to another party.
And there's a guy in the background at this party with an amazing plaid suit. I wish they had focused on him. I couldn't get a good look at it.
You know, he's probably the most stylish guy on Romulus.
Yeah.
I mean, he had like a little black on there and gray. I mean, 2 colors.
Yeah.
The Romulans must be freaking out at that. He's a little bit of a radical.
Maybe he really wasn't a Romulan.
Oh, that's true. Could be.
He might have been the spy. That's who we should have been looking at.
Something about this scene. You notice that Sloan says wheel when he talks about putting the adhesive onto Julian's hand.
He does say we.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think he might be playing up to Julian this sense that there are operatives everywhere.
Yeah. It's not a bad way to play it.
Well, no.
Because you undermine Julian's comfort constantly.
Right, right.
I mean, he says it at one point, there's no one to trust. But I mean, he really can't trust anyone because they keep telling him that he can't.
Great strategizing by Sloan. Well, we're at this now third party, is it, Kim?
Mm-hmm, third party.
There doesn't seem to be a bar, though, so I don't think this is a good one.
It is very much what conferences are like, where, yeah, in between the panels, you're all standing around talking to each other.
Well, Julian makes an excuse to shake Koval's hand, and Koval tells Julian he would like to discuss another matter, ushering Julian to more comfortable facilities, all the while Sloan is watching in the background. And then Julian is taken to what looks like an interrogation chamber, complete with 2 armed Romulan heavies and a single chair.
Yeah, never follow the head of an intelligence agency.
Yeah, especially when they want a private discussion in somewhere more comfortable.
Yeah, don't do that. Don't do that.
Yeah.
I really did not buy that the Romulan would shake his hand. I was suspicious of the whole plan from there.
Oh, interesting.
Especially when we later see him wearing gloves, but he's not wearing gloves in that scene.
That's a good observation.
Mm-hmm.
In the more comfortable surroundings, Koval has the thugs put some kind of sensor on Julian's head, telling him, I will know what you know. After the break, Koval returns and seems somewhat disappointed that Julian's microcellular structure is not susceptible to their scanning technology.
That's handy.
He blames this on a side effect of Julian's genetic enhancements. They then take Julian to a hearing of the Continuation Committee, and sitting before it is Cretak. The Romulan Praetor, Nival, which we learned earlier in the show, announces that Senator Cretak has been charged with trying to access a Tal Shiar database, and she's told a remarkable story. Julian then spills the beans, telling them of the plot to kill Koval, about Section 31, and how Cretak was the only one he could trust, and they were trying to find the traitor. The Praetor asks Cretak why she didn't come to him with this. Cretak makes an excuse that she was worried of the details of the plot would leak out and it would damage the Alliance. I don't know. If the actual head of your government isn't really trustworthy, that you can't trust them with this kind of thing, I think you've got bigger problems.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah. Maybe there's a problem here with the Romulans. Like I mentioned before, how what did Cretak have to do to get to this position, along with like all the way the other Romulan senators believe? I think Cretak was looking to be a hero. Why she was keeping it to herself. And I'm thinking maybe she could even upstage Koval that despite all his resources, she alone found the traitor, because she wouldn't give Julian any credit.
Oh, yeah. No.
You know, maybe her own ambition was the reason why she didn't go to the head of the government. Because if she went to him and told them, you know, she'd learned this information, I would bet he would take credit for the whole thing. Oh, yes, I discovered it. I solved the problem.
Well, that's certainly one of the reasons why she could have kept it to herself. Yeah. It also could have been that she just was worried that Julian was setting her up.
Oh.
She had no trust for him, and so she was just trying to keep it quiet to see if there was any evidence of this. That's another reason.
Make it seem like she was crying wolf.
Yeah, and then that would hamper her political ambitions.
Yeah.
There's also a possibility she just made a bad decision.
Yeah.
Because she does say that she regrets that decision.
Oh, maybe she's something rare among the Romulans of she actually took Julian at face value and believed she was doing the right thing.
Right. It could be that too.
Koval then asks to bring in another witness, and two Romulans bring in Sloan, who looks very beaten up. I think he resisted interrogation.
Yeah, he looks bad.
Koval tells the committee that under questioning, Sloan confirmed much of the story, except one big part of it. There is no Section 31. Sloan is just Starfleet intelligence. He was a protege of the late Admiral Fujisaka and believed the Admiral was murdered and thus wanted revenge. So he invented Section 31, because if they murdered the head of the Tal Shiar, Starfleet intelligence would be blameless. Koval now outlines a plot to accelerate the Tuvan syndrome, and we learn the committee already knows Koval has it. He goes on to tell them Sloan made one mistake. He came to Romulus, but they already knew who he was. Soon as he was recognized, they knew an intelligence operation was underway. Koval asks Sloan, why did he take the risk? Why did you come here? And Sloan tells him he wanted to make sure nothing went wrong, and he wanted to watch Koval die. Koval very mockingly says Sloan broke the one rule of their profession. You don't take it personally. Koval continues saying he doesn't know if the doctor intended to kill him or save him, and that Cretak is ambitious, so it's possible she'd welcome his death if she could get a seat on the committee. Cretak objects, saying she tried to save his life, and very coldly, Koval calls her a fool, saying she let herself be manipulated by Starfleet intelligence into committing acts of treason.
He's not wrong.
The committee look at each other and there's a lot of nodding, and the Praetor announces, it is the finding of this committee that Senator Cretak has conspired to commit treason against the state. Poor Cretak, she looks completely shocked here. The Praetor continues saying, her sentence will be passed later. Dr. Bashir is to be returned to his ship, but Sloan is to be remanded into the custody of the Tal Shiar for some more torture. I mean questioning. Sloan shouts no and grabs the phaser from one of the Romulan security, but before he can do anything, Koval shoots him, and Sloan is vaporized in front of everyone. We go back to Voyager, flying through space and pretending to be the Bellerathon, and Bashir now goes to see a fully recovered Admiral Ross. Bashir then asks him, where's Sloan? The Admiral tries to bluff, but Bashir just asks him again, where's Sloan? Ross then takes off his Starfleet badge, saying, if we're having this discussion, then it's off the record.
He didn't have to do that. He could have just said, I don't know what you're talking about.
I know, right? And Bashir is a junior officer compared to an admiral, so could just say, get the hell out before he put you up on a charge.
Mm-hmm.
So Bashir has figured it all out. Sloan was not someone to get so easily captured by the Romulans and to pull the wool so thoroughly over Bashir's eyes. He also notes that it was the Admiral who planted the idea that Sloan had an accomplice, and also didn't want to tell the Romulans about an assassination plot while preventing contact with Deep Space Nine, and then mysteriously had an aneurysm, leaving only Cretak for Julian to turn to. The Admiral admits He doesn't know where Sloan is. He was supposed to be beamed away right before the phaser hit him. He goes on to tell Julian that Koval has been working with Starfleet intelligence for over a year, providing critical military intelligence. As for Cretak, she'll be dismissed from the Senate and most likely imprisoned. Julian gets annoyed, saying, "Why did you set up an innocent woman? She was on our side." Ross replies, "I told you before, she is a patriot. If it serves the interests of the Romulans to make peace with the Dominion, she would push for that option." I think this is another example of where Julian is really kind of naive.
Yeah.
It's like she's an ambitious politician. If the wind blows this way, she's going to go with it.
Yeah, she's not an innocent.
Right.
Although you don't really see that in this episode. We've seen it before with this character.
In what way?
Well, when she was trying to secretly get weapons onto the moon of Bajor.
Oh, yes. Right. Very much so.
When she was played by a different actress.
Yeah. There's some more exposition, and Ross continues that this way Koval will become Starfleet's guarantee. A man almost killed for his anti-Federation work. His recommendations to stay in the war become way more convincing. Julian asks Ross how long he's worked for Section 31. And Ross admits it's something of a temporary alliance. He didn't like this, but it was necessary. But after a year of ordering men and women to their deaths, he's prepared to do it. Julian gets very upset, taking the completely holier-than-thou position, saying, "This is trampling on the very principles that these people were trying to protect. You know, the view from the ivory tower is so nice. You can, like, barely see any of the peasants from up here."
It would have been nice to have heard Julian give the sanctimonious speech to Sisko.
Yes.
And for them to have a conversation. It was a little bit harder with Ross because they don't have a relationship.
Right.
But when you look back on the things that Sisko has had to do to stay ahead, he may have had a different take on this conversation.
Right. Ross now quotes the name of the episode, "Inter Arma Enim Silent Leges." In times of war, the law falls silent, which is a quote from Cicero. Roman history time. He was an ancient Roman statesman, lawyer, scholar, philosopher, writer, and academic skeptic who lived in Rome around 106 BCE. So there's some unwanted education.
That's a long time ago.
A frustrated Julian says, "Is this what we've become? A modern Rome where Caesar can do no wrong?" Ross doesn't rise to the bait and just tells Julian, "This conversation never happened," and puts on his badge.
Then you shouldn't have had the conversation.
Yeah. Julian picks up his badge and leaves. Back on DS9, Julian is asleep in his quarters, and the camera pans back to reveal Sloan sitting in his chair. He tells Julian he just wanted to say thank you. This is why they chose him. They wanted someone who in this situation would do the right thing. He reached out to the enemy. He told the truth and tried to stop a murder. Sloan says, "The Federation needs men like Julian, a man of conscience, of principle. And that's why Section 31 exists. Someone has to protect the men like Julian from a universe that does not share his sense of right and wrong." Julian sarcastically asks, "Should he be weeping over the burden Sloan is required to carry in order to protect us?" Sloan smirks and laughs, saying, "It is an honor to know you, Doctor," and then leaves. Julian calls security, and when Odo replies, he just says, "Never mind," and lays back down. The end. Well.
Yeah.
I thought that ending was really good because it was almost like a mirror of the conversation with Garrick earlier. Of, you know, Garrick saying how Julian is always upbeat. He's always he takes the right position. And Sloan doing the same kind of thing of saying, you know, you do the right thing. Good for you.
Yeah, but was he also saying, we need those of you who think this way because you're the people we can manipulate?
Ooh, that's a very dark way of looking at it.
If everybody was Garrick, it would be a lot harder.
I think Garrick and Sloan really, you get those two in a bar, I'd love to see them having a chat.
They should be friends. Yeah, they should be friends.
Yeah.
I thought the episode ended one scene too late.
Really?
I didn't think we needed that sort of tie everything up with a bow ending. it would have been better if it remained sort of ambiguous what happened to Sloan.
Yeah.
And if he got away, because then they could have used him again.
Yeah, I would agree.
This way it's like, oh, see, yes, he is fine. And it gave Julian one more chance to be sanctimonious. It was too much. What I would rather have seen, I guess I jumped into my overanalysis, but what I would rather have seen is Julian reflecting on his own part in all of this.
Yeah.
Instead of him just like, oh, everybody is bad but me.
Right.
It's like, no, man, look at yourself. Look at yourself in the mirror. Look how easy you were to manipulate. Look how naive you're being.
Mm-hmm.
And spent some time, I guess, just thinking about his own part in it. Like even finishing up a conversation with Garrick might have been better than this. It just seemed like we got a lot of Julian preaching.
I think that would have been an interesting take, actually having a final scene with Garrick discussing these events with Julian. And almost, if you like, Garrick saying to him, I told you so.
Mm-hmm.
If you like repeating that line from Sloan again to show that parallel of saying, these are not nice people.
That would have been good. Yeah.
That would have been great.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think it was a bad ending with Sloan, but I agree.
I just think it could have been better, I guess was my point. Yeah. Well, do you have overanalysis?
Yes, I do. I think the first one, if Julian was truly a man of principle, kind of like Picard, he'd have left that badge on the table and just walked out of Ross's office.
Yeah.
I think by him returning to his normal duties, he's implicitly accepting the existence of Section 31 and what they do as part of Starfleet and the Federation. I think if you were going to be that ivory tower principled person, your reaction would be to hell with you. Is that unfair?
No, I don't think so. This is kind of ties in with what I'm saying, is that he just washes himself clean of the whole thing. It's like, you're still in this. You're still in Starfleet, who does operate this way. It's not just one person.
Right.
It's not just Sloan. It's not just Ross. So I guess it's not just two people. This is something that's been going on. And if you don't want to be a part of that, then you need to take a stand. But he didn't.
Right. Yes. Next thing.
Mm-hmm.
Sloan is engineered like Julian. He knew exactly how to play Julian, how to pull the wool over his eyes. I think when he recruited Julian, there was that line about them recruiting exceptional people. This whole thing worked because Sloan is like Julian.
Yeah, I think you're probably right, because otherwise Sloan is too good.
Yes.
He's that ridiculous villain that's always one step ahead and understands exactly how everything is going to happen. Too perfect of a villain. So it would make sense, yes, if he were enhanced in some way.
Right.
I getcha.
Sloan seems very smart, but also devoid of conscience or remorse, able to do things that the enlightened Federation citizens are incapable of, and as we saw, can outthink Julian and outplot Julian. I feel, personally, this episode spells that out here, that Sloan is maybe one of these enhanced individuals.
That's almost the only explanation.
Yeah.
Unless he's an AI of some kind, like the
Moriarty.
Section 31 guy in Discovery. No. The guy in Discovery who was Section 31, who was eventually the AI.
Next thing. I like in some ways how this is something of a parallel with Sisko's dilemma in Pale Moonlight.
Yeah.
And I think it's another wonderful example of, I don't know if this is the right name for it, but the reasonable person fallacy. I'm reasonable. You're reasonable. Therefore, everybody must be reasonable, including my enemies. And sort of Sisko, faced with this, is prepared to do whatever it takes. Sloan and Sisko almost like being on the same page of the ends justify the means. Whereas Julian is very much the, I have to do the right thing all the time. And I liked how it's, in some ways, it shows the difference between Sisko and Julian.
That's a good point. I mean, there's a definite parallel between those two episodes. And of course, the one episode has like the perfect ending.
Yes.
I didn't think this one had the perfect ending, but that is a good point that it shows the differences. However, when we look at statistical probabilities, the way that the augments in that episode were reacting was they were basically putting morality, well, it wasn't morality in that case, it was ethics aside. Because they were going to go and give secrets to the Dominion to help end the war sooner. So for them, the ends definitely justified the means. So to me, this really shows how different Julian is from
the other
augments.
Right.
And I'm not sure he should be.
Yeah.
I don't quite understand why he holds that moral high ground so much.
Interesting.
That to me seems in conflict with his augmentation.
Well, maybe he is an enhanced version of humans like Picard from that mindset.
Yeah. It's a tricky one because you would think that someone who is capable of such analysis would find a way to make the ends justify the means.
Oh.
So, I don't know. It's a weird contradiction to me.
This, if anything, makes Julian much more interesting because...
Meh.
Well, I think it does because here's my justification here.
He's just so preachy. You know, I don't like it when...
Yes, he is a little preachy, but I think you would have to manipulate Julian to doing this because I think if you explain to Sisko, like Pale Moonlight, if you said, this is what we need to do because we need Koval on this committee because he's one of the good guys, even if it's in inverted commas, Sisko would say, you know, maybe he'd moralize about it, but he'd do it because, well, to quote Sisko, I can live with this. Julian, on the other hand, maybe Sloan knows it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what the ends are. It doesn't matter how this benefits them. He will say no because it's morally wrong.
Hmm. It's quite the moral conundrum.
Yeah. Next thing. So what on Earth, or on Romulus, is Koval's motivation here? What's making him do this?
That's a great question. I was wondering that too. I guess... staying in power?
Yeah.
We've talked about this before with many things going on the Cardassian side. And we quite frequently with Dukat, with Garrick, and it was always about either were they protecting themselves or were they protecting Cardassia?
Right, right. Well, we know what it was with Dukat.
It was always himself. But with Garrick, it was always that pristine vision of Cardassia.
The idealized Cardassia.
So what is it for this Romulan? What is he actually getting out of it? Is it, if he forms these alliances, he could be playing them all.
That's true.
And just gathering information himself to use once the actual little treaty breaks up. It could just be as simple as that.
Right.
But he's certainly opening himself up to getting caught and... being accused of treason.
Being seen as a traitor, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I have headcanon here.
Okay.
He's reached the top of his profession, and he sees how corrupt and petty the Romulan hierarchy is. Add to that...
he's dying.
He has a diagnosis. Yeah, that he's dying.
Mm-hmm.
He either wants to bring it all down, to hell with everyone, or, and I think this would be the more Star Trek, he wants to bring down his enemies so he can reach the top and bring in his people who would actually want real change within Romulus. So he would bring in basically forward thinkers, the equivalent of Romulan progressives. And perhaps even at the end of the day, he would like that reunification with the Vulcan family.
It just dawned on me that even the scene where he was asking Julian how to make the quickening happen was part of this whole plot.
Yeah. Oh, agreed.
I didn't put all that together because, he's part of the whole thing. So what is he doing?
Right.
So
I headcanon my way into it.
Well, of course, you always headcanon your way through stuff. And I mean, I guess it could be that he ultimately is trying to build a better Romulus with himself in charge.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what all the Romulans are like. You know what? If I were in charge, this would be
everything would be better. It only needs me to be running everything.
Exactly. It could be.
All right, next one. So stuffed shirt Ross is a lot trickier than we thought.
Not as stuffed as we thought.
Do you believe this was a temporary alliance with Section 31? I'm going with he is, was, and remains an operative of Section 31.
I don't know what to believe about Section 31. I'm not sure the writers know. Because we're playing fast and loose with the whole thing. Like, oh, they don't admit that it exists, but they do admit that it exists. It seems like maybe not all the admirals know about it. Some of them know about it. So you got to believe the ones that know about it, they're either a part of it or they get killed off.
Well, this leads into my next point, which is corrosive influence.
Yeah.
If Section 31 believes it is doing the right thing all the time and it is for the benefit of Starfleet, then I would see them actively moving admirals into positions that would help Section 31.
Agreed.
And that would be a problem. Because you'd end up with Section 31 becoming too powerful. There'd really be the risk of them seeing what's in their best interests being in the best interests of the Federation as a whole. Their mindset would be almost this circular logic. If we do a bad thing for a good and noble organization, therefore, how could that thing really be bad? So it must really be good. So you'd run this risk of Starfleet basically being run by Section 31 over an extended period of time because they'd be putting people that help them in places of power.
Yeah. I'm torn about the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I can see why people complained about it when it first came up. I'm torn about it because it really should be a secret organization.
Like, truly,
it shouldn't even have a name.
Yeah.
And they shouldn't be talking about it. It should just be a thing, like there's a black ops group that we use to go and do this, and it should almost be transient.
Yeah.
It shouldn't exist all the time and be making its own decisions, unless it was completely separate.
Right.
And the only agreement they had, there was no communication between the Starfleet admirals and this group. The only agreement they had was you won't arrest the people in this group.
Right.
Because they're doing something for our future.
I would think, let's go a step further and say, maybe it even needs to be, they would arrest them if they get caught, because...
Like the IMF, like the Impossible Mission Force.
Right, almost like that.
Yeah. Yeah, we will deny that we know anything about you. That's a good point. You get arrested, you get arrested.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, the reason I'm torn is that's not very Starfleet, but what they do isn't very Starfleet.
Yes.
But I also get that in times of war, you can't always do the right thing.
Yeah.
This is why I should never be involved in war, because I would not know what to do. I would be paralyzed by, yes, the ends might have to justify the means.
Yes.
No, I can't always take the high ground. It would be impossible for me to make any decision, but I certainly wouldn't do things like in the quickening. Besides all that, I mean, this is, to me, why I'm so torn, because I get the reason for it existing. I don't like it in Starfleet,
yeah.
And partly because it does undermine the way that we have spent 50 years thinking about Star Trek and Starfleet.
Yeah, because it becomes how much of Starfleet is influenced by Section 31, whereas Section 31 should be this hidden thing that you only use.
Rather than the other way around. Yes, it's like too much religion in your politics.
Right? Yeah,
that it's sort of that same thing. They end up corrupting each other.
Agreed.
Because of power. Yeah.
And my final point this time, I'm pretty sure 99.9% of the Bellerathon, totally not Voyager, crew are Starfleet Intelligence or Section 31. The chance of getting firsthand operational information and intelligence on the Romulans in their home system, you'd be crazy missing out on that.
Totally. Yeah. You'd be negligent not to.
Yeah.
I agree.
Okay, and one final point, because we haven't had one in a while.
Okay.
Do you think it's a good idea for Admiral Ross to tell Julian about one of their most closely held secrets about the Romulans that the head of the Tal Shiar is working with Starfleet Intelligence, just out in the open?
Absolutely not. I guess that's maybe what's bugging me about it, is that he should have just said no, right? When he's like, oh, where's Sloan? He should have just said, get out, Julian.
Who? Never heard of him.
And then if he couldn't accept that, then he goes to Cisco, right?
Right.
That would have been a better conversation.
Oh.
But yeah, it was hard to buy. I just, that last scene really bothered me. It was hard to buy.
Yeah, gotcha.
Although that wasn't the last scene.
And that wraps up my very long overanalysis. Should we give a warning at the beginning? Maybe people should buckle up.
So much headcanon, so much discussion. Well, I can put it in the show notes. I don't have a lot in my overanalysis that we haven't already talked about. I think they made Sloan too smart of a villain.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I guess since they don't use him very much, it's not so bad. But you're right that he must be augmented in order to beat Julian. Like Moriarty took the computer to beat Data.
Yes.
Yeah. I did for a moment during that mini trial or whatever that was in front of, I guess it was a committee. It's not really a trial. When they were saying that there is no Section 31, I was thinking, oh, maybe there isn't a Section 31. And then I was flipping around going, well, wait, maybe the whole point of this is because they want the Romulans to think there is no Section 31. But it's crazy that you would throw the name of it out there and then just say, oh, yeah, that thing. Oh, no, that doesn't exist.
I thought that was a nice touch.
Now they should change the name. Now we should be Section 32. You got to change the name now. Your brand is blown.
Or even better, you go with some completely generic, boring name that nobody would think would be an intelligence department, like the Department of Air Conditioning Services.
Something like that. I did wonder if it was just Sloan and a couple of people, and there really is no Section 31. They are just some, I don't know, spies that sometimes the admirals buy. They pay for time with them.
Ah, oh, that's an interesting
point. It was a little confusing, the whole thing.
I thought that was a good part of this episode when you first watched it, that they bring up that. And all of a sudden, you're presented with this possibility that, wait a minute, there is no Section 31. It's just this rogue agent on a revenge kick.
Yeah.
Of course, it only works once.
That's true. And I don't see, after watching how they shot and destroyed Sloan, I don't see how he beamed away.
Yes. I'm wondering if they were using some kind of holographic system there.
Oh, maybe he wasn't really there.
Yeah.
But then all those guards would have had to be in on it, too. I guess they could have been.
Yeah. I think if you're a thug in the Tal Shiar, you don't really question your boss very much.
Yeah, you do what you're told.
Yeah.
Makes sense. And then I just have a lot of comments about Bashir being so sanctimonious and taking just no responsibility, which I'll just skip because we already talked about that.
He's really not one of your favorite characters, is he?
Well, no, but they spoiled me with Sisko in the pale moonlight. Yeah. And then to just get the sort of Captain America speech here, it's like, but you were part of it.
Yeah.
And what are you doing about it? Nothing. You're just making speeches and then you just go back to normal. I don't know. Anyway, now I am harping on it. All right, let's go to Women in the Future. And shockingly, I have nothing to say.
Yeah.
At least I didn't pick up on any insults to women in general. I mean, they took down that senator, but that didn't matter. Her gender made no difference.
The Continuation Committee seemed to be mixed genders as well.
They did, yeah. Let's go to rating. Thumbs up, thumbs down, or neutral. What is your rating?
I am thumbs up. I enjoyed this episode. I remember when I watched it originally. And like I said, the first time you watch it through, you get to that point and you go, oh, this was all a con? Section 31 doesn't exist?
Right. And you believe it for a bit. Mm-hmm.
And then you get the whole story and go, wow, this was all an huge, complex plan by Sloan to carry out his agenda.
Yeah.
That's why I like this episode. I feel it works as a good spy story. Mm. It works as a good Star Trek story as well. I think it really exposes that Julian is a true believer. And I kind of like that about Julian. I like that. I think it's one of the better Julian stories. I mean, he hasn't had a lot of great stories. And I think this is one that works.
I agree. This is one of the better Julian stories. Yeah, I give it a thumbs up too. I did have a little Children of Time experience with this one where the first time I watched it, I thought it was really good. And then the second time I was like, is it? And then I kind of started to question some of the things. Yeah. But I agree. This is a pretty good Julian episode and he's pretty good in it.
Yes.
And there's a lot of good acting in it.
Yeah.
Stuffed Shirt Ross, I think it is a bit of a mystery why they chose to do that with that character. I almost would have preferred it if it had been Sisko, but that would have been much harder to get themselves out of. So I suppose it makes sense. They didn't have a lot of choices of who they could utilize. And the reason I'm saying that is because of all the stuff we talked about, where if the admirals are too involved with Section 31, it makes it so much bigger than it's supposed to be. And has too much control over Starfleet, which it's not supposed to.
Yeah, it becomes a vast conspiracy instead of this organization that does these things quietly on the side.
Yeah. And the character of Ross is, like, I didn't think the acting was great by this actor who plays Admiral Ross in this scene. And it's always okay the way that he is because of that sort of stuffed shirt thing.
Yeah,
but here, he was trying to be something else. And it was just a little bit harder to buy.
Oh, interesting.
It's funny that you say you thought it was so rewatchable. I actually don't think it's that rewatchable. I think the more I watch it, the more I would probably pick it apart. But I mean, I only watched it twice. Yeah. Maybe if I watched it a third time, I'd have a different opinion.
Go for the third time. I think the third time's a charm.
Yeah. All right. Okay. I guess that wraps up Season 7, Episode 16. Come back next week for Episode 17.
Which does not have a Latin name.
Good. In the meantime, if you'd like to send us your own overanalysis of this or any episode, or if you just want to say something nice, you can email us at rebingeit@gmail.com, or you can find us on any social media platform at Rebinge It, including YouTube.
At Rebinge It.
We're also there. You can join the Facebook group to interact with us, facebook.com/groups/StarTrekTTMpodcasts.
Thanks for joining us on the Rebinge Deep Space Nine podcast.
That's it for me.
And that's it from me.